Thank you, Vikram. We did more than a minute, but for old time's sake, we forgive you today. I'm delighted to be here, not just because I've known Vikram for a long time, but I think because he and his very able sons and his daughter-in-law, also, who I had the pleasure to meet, are really passionate about the journey that he started. And this is an area which needs an enormous amount of innovation in this country. And to find people who are moving into the space of education, which continues to be, let me say, a rather over-regulated space with very little clarity on how one can operate, represents a very high risk. And is an area which has not changed for a very long time. So to come into an unknown space where you haven't been before, and then to try and do a lot of innovation that we saw here, I think is something very commendable. So I was keen to learn a little bit more about what they're doing, and also then of course to engage with all of you, because all of you are their well-wishers, and we engage with them and contribute to their growth as you benefit from it. What Vikram wanted me to talk about was not something very specific, but to touch upon the education and skills area, more in terms of what are the opportunities for our young. And then specifically talk, leave some thoughts behind on what all of us in this room, let me use the term elders as we talk about students and the young, perhaps some of the ideas that you need to carry forward to bring about the big change that all of us are looking for as we look at the young in this country. So I posed myself with four questions on which I'll give a few comments. Because it's important to understand the context in which all of us are doing in education, what we are doing, or what needs to be done in education. So first and foremost, a context setting, a few minutes on, you know, where have we arrived in society at this point in time? First question, and a little bit of, kind of journey of where we as a society are as it pertains to how education has to be relooked at. Second question is, so we've arrived here, so what's going on here? What are some of the very important and defining forces at work which are shaping how people learn, how society learns, and how we prepare our young? Third question I want to talk about is, you know, what are the opportunities for our young? Not just in types of jobs, but the world they're getting ready for. What kind of expectations should they have? What kind of expectations should society have on the nature of work they have to do and the nature of life they have to lead? And finally, I think, the question for all of us here, that what is our responsibility as elders, whether they are elders as individuals or organizations? What is our responsibility? And what are the few things that we should focus on as we guide the young and as we encourage them to do the right set of things? And this particularly pertains to what I would like each one of us in this room to think about as we go home tonight. So where are we at? I think that's the first question. And I'm going to very briefly share my own understanding of how society has evolved. Not too much detail, but to say that we've moved from the so-called industrial era into the knowledge society, or for some time used the word information era, but I think that was a limiting word. So this move from the industrial era, where preoccupation was with machines and manufacturing, has happened rather rapidly, but it's a very fundamental change. It's a very, very fundamental change, and part of the challenge in society is that society hasn't adjusted to this change. Most of our institutional structures, our operating mindset are still stuck in the industrial era. And to that extent, we are not preparing our young appropriately. So let me just define dimensions of this change, because that will be the setting as we go to the last question of what should you do as you engage with the youngsters. So in the industrial era, all of us remember that we learned management, and management was about managing five resources. And so men and women, men, machines, materials. You have a raw material, you put it into the machine, something comes out, the essence of manufacturing. Money, and then methods. These were the five M's of management, and management education. When it responded to the industrial era of how do we manage manufacturing and how do we manage corporations. So the body of knowledge, the term is management, got organized to help us develop leaders who would deal with these five resources. Men, machines, materials, money, and methods. Now very gently, but very definitively, society has moved beyond manufacturing, much like it went from an agricultural era into an industrial era. In the developed world, very rapidly, very few people, less than a single digit percentage of people still in agriculture. Most went into manufacturing. But the third move has been beyond manufacturing into what we may call the services sector. India itself is now 70% or so in the services sector, and in the developed world, even higher. But this move into what we would call it the knowledge era from the industrial era is different, because if you look at the resources that we learned and we built a whole education system to manage, those five resources, it was men when we looked at manufacturing, and now we have in services sector as many if not more women. So using the word men in the industrial era was appropriate because we had large machines, very hostile working conditions, and women couldn't quite work. So the one fundamental difference is that have we adjusted ourselves in dealing with women in the workplace, and I think all of us agree that in spite of being at it for a long time, we still struggle with that one resource of how to manage women, for example. Second resource was the machine. And the industrial era actually focused human energy on the machine to the extent that we started talking about factories or robotics as a method to remove the human being out of the equation. So when we talk of ghost factories, we used to study about that in our college days. We basically said that in the linear move of people and machines, people are becoming less and less important. The machine is central, and the robots will do everything that people do, and men take leave, they fall ill, they do all kind of troublemaking things at the workplace, so get them out of the man-machine equation. But when we go into the services sector, we are pushing the machine out of that equation. So sometimes we say the computer is the machine, but that's really not so. The computer is just an extension of the human mind, like a calculator is, for example. So this second resource, which was the machine, which became central in the industrial era. And therefore we had industrial disputes and all kind of social problems in the workplace. This has shifted back to the machine being the human being. And I'll use the word mind more loosely. Mind being the machine. And society hasn't quite adjusted itself to see this as the fundamental resource instead of the machine. Our education systems, where engineering, for example, has moved into primacy. Last 10 years, or let's say 1999, we had 1 lakh engineering students enrolled every year. And that number has gone to 16 lakhs, the number of seats available in this 12 years, more than any other district. So at a time when actually engineering is on the waning period, we are responding in industrial era mode to build more capacity to deal with machines. And the social sciences, which have been pushed back in the industrial era, are the need of the hour, but we still find that is a low ranking if a student has to make a choice. And as parents and elders will advise them, do engineering, don't do psychology, don't do sociology. Whereas the subject of critical importance in the machine and the human mind is not engineering. It is humanities, it is liberal arts, but of course it's more complex areas like psychology and so on. So the second resource, complete changes from machine to the mind. Materials was raw materials. Still is important, manufacturing is not unimportant. But in the machine, which is the human mind, and I use the computer as an alibi for it. The raw material is information, and the finished good is information. So I talk to a colleague, if I'm trying to create an idea, I get some information, but I give back an idea, which is information in another form. So from materials, which is atoms as we call it, now the resource that we deal with is information, which is bits. And this is another very fundamental change, because material is limited in nature. If you have 1 kilo of something and two people have to share it equally, you get 0.5 kilo each. And all our economics in the world, all our methods of manufacturing and accounting are governed around the fact that materials are limited. And if you divide them into parts, 5 equal parts, you get 1/5 each. With information, that is not so, that law breaks down completely. I may have 1,000 bits of information, and I can make perfectly equivalent 1,000,000 copies of those 1,000 bits and give it to 1,000 people. And everybody, or 1,000,000 people, will get exactly the same information. So from a scarcity mentality model of managing resources, we haven't made the adjustment to the abundance mentality model, where information can be replicated at close to zero marginal cost, whereas materials cannot be replicated. This is a very fundamental shift, and again society hasn't adjusted. So when we talk of how the dot-com bust and boom happened, because society didn't know how to deal with this limitless resource, which you can duplicate at close to marginal cost. So our education system hasn't adjusted. Now we hear of online education, people don't know how to price it. So there's this massive online, open online courses, or MOOCs as they are called, which MIT and Stanford and all these people are putting together. They're delivering it, but they don't know how to make money. They've been at it for a decade plus, but they don't have a business model, because the economics is predicated on the fact that if I give somebody so much time on the faculty and so much space in a room, and one book, those resources are limited. But now we have a situation where you can replicate, because bits can be duplicated close to zero marginal cost. The fourth resource, money, remains money. I think that hasn't changed much, just getting more digital. And the fifth is method, we use the word process. But I think the big, big change in the industrial era to knowledge era, which we society has not adjusted to, and I'm going to build on that and go forward, is the machine at the center is an old concept. It's mind at the center. So we've arrived and made this journey. The second big change in which setting our young are going is a world that is globalizing. So people can move far more easily from one part of the world to the other, faster, quicker, cheaper. But more than that, bits can flow, because goods and services are more and more. So a math teacher sitting in a village in India, at the age of 80, can't walk around too much, but could very well get connected to 10 students in 10 parts of the world simultaneously and teach them mathematics. So bits can flow. And connectivity is making it possible for the world to get connected. You talked about global village and all of that, but the world truly is now globalized and connected. And in that sense, a family, quite at war with each other, but so are many families. But connected, the world is connected. And in this globalized world, the young people have to deal with this reality, that my customer is not sitting in this room, could be at the other end of the globe. And I could accept that customer with greater ease than I have to go from one part of Calcutta to the other, for example. So this is the second reality, which is that young people are entering a world where they are connected to everybody else on earth, and they can move around easily, and their work can move around easily. The third aspect of the place where we've arrived is this move towards democracy. And I think the fall of the wall moved the needle strongly away from any other form toward democracy. But I'm personally at this time confused on whether that is indeed the panacea. Because if you look at democracies in the last 2 or 3 years, whether you look at Britain, which has gone into a coalition mess, you look at the state of the US in its governance, you look at India, I think democracy is a great test. And we are beginning to talk about the fact that China has a model of governance which is not democracy. But at least the poor are doing a very good job. The middle class is being lifted into a better situation. So we don't quite know what model is the best, and perhaps it will be some hybrid of this. So to go rankling against communism and say it doesn't work, and to say democracy is everything, I think the world is at a crossroad. And therefore the young can't afford to take a position of what is right or wrong. As the world gets globalized, they have to open their mind to all forms of government and perhaps contribute to looking at the sweet spot somewhere in the middle. I was in China with my family for 10 days, a couple of weeks ago. And like we all like to do, I was reading a good book written by a lady called Ayer. She was from the Indian Express, lived in China for a long time. And throughout the book, her dilemma is, you know, which is better, India or China? And she goes through that whole confusion and comparing and contrasting and comparing and contrasting. This looks better here, that looks better there. And in the end, she, you know, many of us who spend time in China can see the pros and cons and find it difficult to judge. But she makes a conclusion in the end, which is quite interesting. She said, if I was to be born a poor person, I'd pray to be born in China, because my needs are met. I can get food, I can get security. But if I'm born rich, then I'd like to be born in India, because I want freedom of thought. I want independence. I want a point of view. And in a sense, the Maslow's hierarchy of needs, that you have basic requirements. And in our country, we do very badly for our poor. Though we are seized with the issue, the magnitude is huge. But we have seen that the wealth is moving upward and upward and not finding its way down there. And that's one problem for our youth, and we talk about that. But to say that democracy is the solution, I think it would be a very limiting view for a young person to build that mind. So this is where we've arrived. We've arrived in the world where the mind is at the center. We've arrived in the world where the minds are all connected. And we've arrived in a world which is confused about how one mind should deal with another in a governance context. So this is where we've arrived. Now what's going on where we've arrived? First and foremost, from the IT world, we are beginning to use the word smack. Not the smack that we used to hear about in college. But this is SMAC. And this captures some very important changes in the way the life setting is changing with technology. So first, the S is social. So you all are involved with Facebook, you're involved with LinkedIn, you're involved with Twitter, YouTube, and a whole lot of ways which are making the way we interact with each other very different. They're completely changing the way in which we interact. And as humans, we are social animals, we're engaging with each other. So how we engage is changing dramatically because of social media. And it's about connected minds. Second, M in SMAC is about mobile. And all of us know that, but essentially what mobile here means is we could be anywhere when we want to do something. In that dimension, as against the technology called mobile, that whatever I want to do, I can do from wherever I can. I don't have to be stuck at a table or a chair. The A is about analytics. And you'll be hearing more and more the phrase which is big data. So analytics is about dealing with large volumes of data which are now getting electronically captured. So each of you from morning till evening today can perhaps count on the 7 or 8 or 10 transactions you would have done where data got captured in electronic form. And maybe some of you would have done, if you're a youngster, you would have gone on to Google maybe 100 times. And every time you went, Google figured out something about you. If you use your credit card, someone figured out something about what you spent on what. And this data is all getting interconnected. And now it's possible, very intelligently, with proper copyright privacy acts or whatever, to figure out things which are happening far better than we've ever done before. So analytics now, for all of us as managers, we can get much more insightful views of how people are living and doing and what they're doing through analytics. And therefore, we are also vulnerable to that extent. And finally, the fourth term is cloud. proceed. So cloud is a technology, but let me simplify it by saying that today, if you have, let's say, a hair blower as a device and you want to use it, you don't set up a generating plant at home. You go to the wall, there's a plug, you put it in, it works. And many other things which have a plug can be put in the same place. An audio player, a fan, whatever, it all goes into the same plug. And what happens behind the plug, where is the core moving to get the energy? Is it coming from a hydro plant? Where the generation is happening is not my problem. I have a utility. So when we use the word cloud in IT terms, it basically is beginning to give us an impression that just like for power we have a plug, for information also we have a plug. And what is happening behind the plug? Where are the disk drives? Where are the computers? Where is the connectivity? Where is everything else? Where are the databases? Is becoming further and further back behind the wall. And that's the term we use for cloud, which means that computing capability is becoming a utility where I can plug into something and get what I want. And if you have an intelligent device or a smartphone, you know what we're talking about here. So this is one thing which is changing, and is changing particularly for the executives and working world, on how we engage with each other, how we communicate, how we get access to information, and how we deal with this phenomenal computing resource which comes from cloud or software. So this is one thing which is going on here and which is changing the life and will change and is changing the life of young people. The second is that there's a DMAT. We've heard of DMAT in share, right? You have a share and you dematerialize it. You converted the atoms into bits, essentially, on a piece of paper. It became digital. So there's a DMAT of everything which is happening. More and more and more things are getting dematerialized. So when you now hear of, you know, mechanical parts can be printed on a computer because you just put layers of information. Information can come from anywhere. So DMAT of money is happening with a credit card. You don't have to carry the note anymore. Now you can transfer money on the mobile phone. So dematerialization is this movement of atoms to bits. And it's happening in all services, every service is exchange of information and therefore exchange of bits and therefore can be dematerialized. So DMAT of things is now making it possible for young people to do more and more stuff on their digital device. The life engages 1,000 items, 800 of them are dematerialized. So visualize the difference of what it means to young people. The third thing which is going on here, when we talk of here, is that, you know, we used to talk of melting pot of cultures. Melting pot is a good word, we said that you have diversity and you put it together. The world, I think the youth is moving into what I would call as a simmering pots, which are becoming boiling pots in many parts of the world, like the Arab Spring. So simmering pots, to me, is a better definition of where the youth are. They are engaged, they are getting agitated, and if they're not handled well, because of this extensive connectivity, they can simmer and boil over. So this is another space, when we look at the space we're in. So to me, Anna Hazare 1.0 is a simmering pot. It didn't boil over, but it's a beginning. It's a beginning. And we're beginning to see the simmering spots happening in many places, and that's another thing that we as elders have to think about when we look at our young. And the fourth thing of what's going on here is the fundamental transformation of education. It's very basic. And it was very nice to hear the many aspects of change which Globsyn is leading, having been in it now for a number of years. And I think the obsession that team has on transforming, changing, innovation, research, and all of those good words. And that's transforming. And again, if you look at the SMAC, you know, what will social do? Learning is a social process. So if actually at 10 different places, 10 people at 10 different places can engage with each other and do collaboration, which is a necessary thing we do in a classroom, classroom changing. With mobile, you can be learning from anywhere. You can be teaching from anywhere. With analytics, you can start gathering tons and tons about information of what to study, how to find out, how to get market segmentation or whatever, human behavior, you know, millions of deaths of individuals to study their behavior as HR people. And of course, cloud being the infrastructure which all this happens is becoming a socket to walk. So education is transforming, not only through technology. I think the other big change is the purpose of education is changing as we go from earlier periods, not just the industrial era, but the empire, for example, being part of an empire at one time. And all of us started getting agitated about what the British did or what Macaulay did in famous minute that he wrote in 1853 or somewhere, where he said that we have to rule this nation, we need to change education. And we need to create a set of people who will listen to instructions as they are told. Because as a little nation sitting in Europe, we can't govern the large world unless we regulate education. And so when we curse our education system of kids can't think, it's all rote, it is coming from an origin where the purpose of education was to build clerks in very large numbers who would follow processes and conform and not question too much. And we moved the whole period to saying our children need to think. This is a free world. People can build enterprises. We want to be independent. So from the empire, the word is empower, really speaking. Just a complete 180-degree change. So the role of education has changed, but we haven't changed. We still want to do the same exam. We curse the system. But we haven't realized that it's not about empire anymore. Even a corporation, and the thing about corporation that all of us are reading, and I'm sure all of you read on this subject, is that growth is jobless. It's a wrong conclusion. Growth is jobless in large companies. Because the jobs are not growing in large companies anymore. Because young people are becoming job creators. In a three-person company, or a virtual company where 1,000 people get together and do a project and disassemble by the end of the day. And we don't count them, we count them as jobless. So we have a very wrong notion about what the job of the future is. And we're still stuck in listed companies which have stock options and all of those things. And even when growth came back, the US, I remember last time around, job didn't come back. And this time, of course, they've had a very difficult period of bright young kids coming out of Stanford and sitting home for 3 years because there were no jobs. So now jobs are coming back, but we don't count a large number of jobs which are young do, and I'm sure all of you have kids, and sometimes you wonder why don't they get a steady job. But they're busy, they're doing stuff, they're creating value. And they are getting empowered. So, in the last 150 years, I would say, since Macaulay wrote the doctrine to build our education system and repurpose it from what it was earlier, of a highly regulated control thing, we're still stuck in it, and I don't know how many decades it will take to get out. But we're seeing a phenomenon where young people are getting liberated, and they go to Khan Academy, and they'll do algebra sessions there, online, and maybe not attend the class, but get full marks because they want to learn in a different way. And this whole smack phenomenon is making it possible. So I still have to give an exam, I still need a certificate. But that's not where I'll study. I'll study my own way. So this is where we are. So in where we are, as I said, the smack is one part, the DMAT of things, the 7-8 parts, and a fundamentally new way of learning. This is what's going on where we are. And in this space, I come to the third question after saying, where have we arrived and what's going on here, I come to what are the opportunities for our young? How do we as elders recognize? So one is the thing which has been talked about, the demographic dividend. It's been talked of often. And basically, what it will mean is we are one of the youngest nations. But by 2021, two-thirds of Indians will be in the working age population. Two-thirds of a population. It's a huge, huge, huge figure. And around that time, in 2020, the average age in India will be 29, will be 37 in China and the US, will be 45 in Europe, and it will be 48 in Japan. Now this actually has a huge implication on the opportunities for youth and our expectations of them. So if you look at Japan, average age of 48, you'll see how many people are not in a physical position to work. And that number will be much larger than those who are working. So that society will have an inverted triangle where a few people are working and supporting a much larger number of people who cannot work. Which is a scary challenge. We can see it even now if you go into Japan. You can see it in many parts of Europe. So the almost an implosion that happened in UK when they had to cancel the retirement benefits given to old people, because retirement benefits are collected out of taking a tax on a person who's working. So now, earlier 100 people were working and 10 were old, so they were retired and they could get pension. Then that became 50 and 50, now it's 10 and 100. So 100 young people working have to be taxed to support 90 more who are old. It's not sustainable. So society and the world are moving into that issue, whereas India is still a long way to go into reaching a period where a large number of young people can comfortably support a much smaller number of old age people. But if I look at the global village, it actually opens up massive opportunity for our young. And the world will want our young people to come, because not anything can be done by people who are in the 80s and 70s. So as a young nation, either people will move or the work of young people will move. And if we talked about the work factor, many kind of jobs can move. So this is what the word demographic means, that every country has gone through a bulge of youth. We have to still go into a bulge. So even 10 years down, 15 years down, we will be still a young nation where the world is going to be dependent on youth. And therefore it, you know, creates a very good medium-term future for our youth to get ready for this time when the world will be dependent on youth. So this is a good part of the story. The other part which I think Vikram very brought out so well is that in this new world where people are employing themselves, not dependent on a certificate to give a job interview, my caliber and capability and ability to produce something is more important than the grades I got. So this shift from education to skills, and education being defined as a method, not as how I grew up and learned, but education as an award-giving process, a title-giving process, a degree-giving process, as distinct from learning something. If I'm an artisan, I learn in my family and I can do a better thing than the previous person. I have to deliver something. So the education and skill divide, and right now it's in favor of education, extraordinary. If you have to get your daughter married, you have a very skilled guy who dropped out of class 10 versus a PhD who's sitting at home. Who do you think is going to get her married? It's a real issue. Today a girl's dowry is determined. The dowry that is demanded is determined on how qualified she is. Even in highly educated families. So the social stigma against just skills which don't have a certificate is a very big hindrance. But the good news is that the confident youth who don't really care about looking for a job in a big company, they are saying that I don't need a degree. I need to learn something which can create value. And since I don't have to have a lot of money to make a machine, to own a machine, and I can create, my machine is here, and I'm capable of delivering value, and I'm individual and empowered, to me skills are more important. And so I think this is a very big shift, but it's stuck because of social stigma. And in the Skills Council where I'm involved, we recognize that the bigger problem for us is not to build institutions which can give skills. The bigger problem is the social mindset of giving higher level value to skills in society. And that's the generational issue. It's not going to happen in 5 or 10 years. So, therefore, the opportunity for our young, but I get inspired by the fact that many youngsters think to help me with a degree. I know what I want to do. When my parents want me to do one degree, I'll do it to satisfy them, but after that, I want to do what I want to do, and they'll normally change their line. And then get on to what they think they really like to do. And that's part of the empowerment. And in my friend circle, all of us earlier looked with a little bit of confusion, but when you see these kids enjoying what they're doing and doing a better job than what they did if they were to pursue the BE or whatever they got. So this empowerment is becoming palpable to those of us who can afford to get the children to make choices, and that is a larger and larger number. So this education skill issue is going to dissolve in rather complicated ways. And therefore what I'm saying is that from being people who look for jobs, my expectation from the youth is that they're idea creators and idea merchants. They're dealing with bits, they're not dealing with atoms. They're not dealing with 5 kilos or something. They're giving a service which generated and created the others. And they give that as bits of information in one form or the other. Even a smile is a bit, it's a pass on emotion. Cost you nothing. We talked about that in the past as well. So the youth as the idea creators and idea merchants is the new way forward. And then I did say that work is mobile. Work has become mobile. As I gave the example of a teacher sitting here and teaching a student anywhere, the work has moved. And if you look at the software industry story, it's all about work becoming mobile. Outsourcing is the first story where work came to India. And it's all getting driven more and more by the social, mobile, analytics, and cloud phenomenon. Because that's where, that's the space where the work happens. And the other thing for young is, and all of us, I guess, recognize this more recently, is the emphasis from teaching them, which is a teacher-centered view of education, to letting them learn. This is a learner-centered view, came up very nicely in some presentations early in the evening. So this shift is getting enabled once again by social, mobile, analytics and cloud. This is a very, very interesting shift. And being involved in this field, myself, some of you may have seen this cloud campus. I don't know, anyone has seen the ad which says, I'm not studying on TV. And this I'm not studying is actually feedback coming from young people who are averse to being taught but want their own way to learn and have fun doing it. And these two methods are making it possible for them to do what they want to do. And when the child is excited, they will learn better than if they're being beaten up. You know all that. So from a push orientation of education, we are very quickly seeing our young make choices about a pull-based model of learning. So learner-centered education versus teacher-centered education. This move is happening very rapidly, and it's very encouraging to see that Globsyn is doing so much work, and I think they're getting led by the phenomena, but they're also leading thought on the phenomena. And while we were waiting for the session to begin, the young Dasguptas, I was delighted to see them looking at ways and means to deal with this whole education space, looking at the problems of the space so very differently from how our regulators and how we as people who think we need to manage education, how they are thinking of it. And in that sense, I think Globsyn has a very good path for its future with the young doing the innovation. So the opportunities for the young, I talked about, essentially saying the future for India, because of the demographic difference, is a lot of work for our young people. We had done a study some years ago before the slowdown happened in CII, along with the Boston Consulting Group. And then we were looking at the years, 20 years ahead, I think we've done in 2002 or 3, when the world was in a different mood. So I think that reality shifted back because of slowdown. But we did a calculation, very good estimation, which showed that by 20 years from then, the world would be short of about 50 million people in the working age group. And India would be roughly surplus, even if we continued our 8% growth, of 50 million people. So the same thing is being articulated differently as the demographic dividend. So that's the first and most important thing for our young. But they are taking charge, they are getting empowered, they are not getting stuck, they are learning what they want to learn, they are following their desires much more. And they are becoming idea creative and idea merchant. And becoming less and less dependent on the great corporation all of us had lived with it and put dealt with in our life. So, a very much more liberated, enabled, motivated, self-driven set of individuals and empowered people. That's the young that we are talking about. And as elders, when we try and manage them, we get very frustrated. Because our view of management is what was applicable to us when we came into the job. And we say, why don't these guys, they don't have loyalty, they're not regular, they don't do this, they don't do that, they don't read, they don't do many things. But if you really sit with them and see what they do, I think they do much better than us. Because they're empowered, they're thinking individuals, they're dealing with bits of information, they're creating ideas, they're not just working in a huge clerical machine. Which is the empire, whether it was the British Empire or all the large corporations. Something similar. And finally, I come to the last part, which is, so what does it mean for us? All of us are here, not just to see what's happening in the world, but to take back some responsibility. Because many of you, I gather, are involved with people, and involved with the young and groups, but more involved in your companies. So basically, this is a little philosophical, but I think it's important for us to recognize that we need to change. We need to guide, we need to coach. We have a big role. We can't afford to say kids are doing well, let them do it. I think there is a role for us which is more philosophical and important. And therefore we have to do whatever it takes to cause a few things to happen, to facilitate a few things, to enable a few things for this young. So we have to prepare them, we have to coach them, we have to counsel them, to guide. That's our role. Not direct or manage or push or incentivize and so on. That model is breaking down. So, what are three things we should teach our young? First is we should teach them to do well, which means they have to build some wealth and value. So do well, we have to coach, guide them so that they get onto a track, so they create some value through their ideas and effort. And today's world only measures it in money terms because M and the resources are still valid. We count it like that. So I truly want to encourage everyone to not get carried away by the child wants to make money. Do well is about that. That should be encouraged. Subject to a couple of things I'll talk about. So do well is very important. I think every young person is capable of creating economic value and we should find ways and means to coach and guide them to do that. And for example, if you're on a plane, when they talk about the oxygen mask, they say there's little oxygen, you first put the mask on your own face so you can become capable of helping. If you put in the mask on everybody else, you'll collapse and so will everybody else. So do well is about getting the oxygen mask for the young so that they stand firm and they have the ability then to do things for others. And I'll come to the second part, which is do good. Which means whatever you're doing has to have a purpose more than just doing well. But initially, I think if you tell them, don't worry about money, do good, I think you're taking the oxygen mask away from them. Not good advice. First, do good, but you start coaching them simultaneously that when you do well and you make money, you can either wait till that time to decide what you want to do with it. By that time, your family will be lawsuits and people trying to change your will because you haven't thought about what you want to do with the wealth you generate. And you start thinking about it too late in life. This is true of most people who made wealth. So do good is about putting at the same time the seed in the young mind that when you become a rich man or a woman, what will you do with the money that you would have gathered? So the only request is, don't put your hard-earned money there today, but think from today. Now let me tell you, I'm involved in education, I have a number of boards, education institutions, schools and colleges, and IIT and IIMs and ISB. And I've seen a very definite shift in the last 15 years of the social sensitivity of children. It's amazing change. It's amazing how many of them are socially responsible and aware at a very young age. So I guess it's part of also Maslow's hierarchy that people are making wealth, children can worry less about eating the next meal they're thinking of. But the awareness is there. Now our job is that while we are telling them to do well, we have to tell them, okay, when you make your million, where will it go? Because only if they keep worrying about making the million, by the time they make it, they've lost out a lot in life, and their money is being claimed by all relatives in the family. And it's true for most cases. But if you start instilling in them, okay, when you make that money, because that time a million looks like, I don't need that much. I can manage it much less. The greed hasn't set in. And then if they're becoming socially aware, socially conscious, they can start saying, ah, then I'd like to do something. So the work which we saw Globsyn doing, students who had been elders, old age homes, they then related to the fact that I'm also going to be there someday. Or I could be that poor person. So that social sensitivity, which going along with what are you going to do with the wealth you generate, will get people to start thinking about being socially more responsible at an early age when they still have it. Once if they're caught in the middle, then you can't pull them out. Then they're just too busy trying to make the next million and the next million. Then they got caught, they get caught on a train they can't get off. So do good is the second piece of advice you could be given to youngsters. And the word inclusiveness, which you know we heard for a long time from Manmohan Singh, and many of us took time to understand, is about this issue that if we don't worry about those who don't, the have-nots, then you will see what happens. And I live in Delhi, in a colony which has nice houses. I've lived there for now 17 years. And when I moved in there, none of the houses had a security guard. Today, everyone has at least one. So who are we trying to protect ourselves from? It's us. It's those of our people who are left behind, who are now getting into the simmering pot and saying, why didn't I get something? And I have no other way except to steal it from you or to stab you. So in selfish interest, our young have to recognize that to build a safer place for themselves, they have to do good. So this, I think, is very important. And then come the last one, which is the most difficult. So do well, they will relate with. Do good, they are beginning to relate with. Third is be good. And I was looking at how the parliament is trying to squash the Supreme Court order, which says you can't be a criminal to be in parliament. What example are you setting? So be good as means that whatever you're doing, don't do it in the right way. And all of us learned it went from one ear, went out from the other and said, who the hell cares? After all, if you're not corrupt, you can't get anywhere. But I think fortunately, the young are getting more sensitive to this issue. And if they're not, I think this is perhaps a very big responsibility we need to take. And be good is to me the more difficult one. I do believe, however, that all of us as young children do have a moral campus. We have an intuitive sense of right and wrong. And it gradually gets pushed down. It doesn't get killed, it gets pushed down. So what can we do, and what should we do from morning till night to deal with a few young people and talk to them, counsel them, and tell them stories about the value of being good? And so good old Gandhi's question of means and ends question. It sounds very hollow to a guy who's on his way up, unless we have done it as in a not as a company policy or a lecture on strategy, but sit with someone, put the arm around the shoulder and say, okay, young man or young lady, what did you do today? Or you behave with that person, was that the right way to do it? Or you're pricing your product with the A, B, C, D, E. This to me is the most important and the most difficult task, because the world is not doing the right thing. I was reading, and those of you who read Zakaria, he's written a very good piece on the state of Washington. And he makes a point that 10 or 15 years ago, a single digit percentage of retiring government officials would get re-employed in Washington. He says now it's some 80% of retiring powerful officials become lobbyists. So a few billion dollars being spent on these lobbyists will determine how trillions of dollars of the nation will be used or abused. So we don't have good role models. And that's our challenge. How do we tell young kids to be good when everybody else around them is not? But all of us know that for our own children, we spend time doing that. And I would say it's not enough to do it for our own children. Because if you look at inclusion and inclusiveness, then if the security guard is trying to ward off the young brat from the corner trying to steal something from your house, unless we do something there, we'll only protect our kids against more and more dangers of the future. And that's the non-inclusiveness which we are worried about. So do well, do good, be good, more or less in a parallel mode where do good and do well and do good can be listened to quite early. But be good is the difficult part. And that's why I like to leave this responsibility in a sense, if I were to say that what would I be happy each of you did. It's your call and you have to decide. But it seems to me when we look at the fundamental problem today in education is that we are teaching them stuff. We are not teaching them do good or be good. In my days in college, there used to be a few hours on the subject called moral science. It got edged out because physics needed more time and maths needed more time. Social science got edged out. So in the industrial era, we had to edge out a lot of things and we have taken the benefit of it. Of course, the middle class wouldn't have been created if you didn't have machines. You wouldn't all be comfortable. So that phase is done. But the new phase where the mind is at the center has not been addressed. So still, the pursuit of ideas of the industrial era are central to our education. And therefore the onus now, we cannot wait for the system to change. The onus, in a sense, has to be on each and every one of us. So I was just wondering, what should I leave behind as an idea? So the only thing I could think of is that each of us have, not very far from our home, a government school. Each one of us. You may not know where the nearest government school is, it won't be very far away. So what if you were to spend half a day every month and try it for 12 months, and I can guarantee if you do those 12 months, you'll want to do it for life. But you may be teaching maths or physics or whatever your subject is, but your concentration with those group of 20, 30, 40 students should be around how should they do well. That's the inclusive group. You know, what's the path for them? You shouldn't underestimate the value of your experience. One good conversation with a young child to give them direction. And all of us, of course, can remember the two or three professors and the two or three conversations which shaped us. Not the thousands of lectures and hundreds of professors. And those things we remember were not how the formula was done. It was some piece of advice which stayed with us. So, in addition to teaching what you wanted, this could be. And the second thing is, if you look at a higher education system, which I watch a little more closely in schools, in our colleges and universities, we have around 600 universities, plus or minus, and about 30, 35, 40,000, whichever way you count the colleges and polytechnics and whatever. Less than half the staff exists. People say 30%, 40%. I think we have less than half the number of teachers we need. So if your companies are retiring you at 60, you have at least 10, if not 20, well, let's say 10 active years, mentally active and physically reasonably active years. And I can guarantee you, if you get this one or half a day a month, you may want to do 10 years full-time work as a teacher in the higher education system. That probably reform our higher education system much more than any kind of policy we can do. So on that note, thanks for your attention and thanks for the opportunity. Thank you.